Hi, friends. Welcome to another episode of Area 312 Rock and Metal Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Kent, along with my co-host,
Rex.
Friends, today we are welcoming someone who led the charge with his soaring and searing vocals on 8 studio albums. He is a recipient, along with his band, of the Soul to Soul Honor Award, and he's also an inductee, along with his band, in the Christian Music Hall of Fame. He is a member of one of the most beloved rock bands under Christendom's umbrella, and he has had more first name spelling changes than the devil's worn disguises. I'm talking about the one and only Rick Florian of Whiteheart. Welcome, Rick. We're glad to have you. Thanks for being here, buddy.
I'm happy to be here. Love hanging with you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And Rick, we know your time is valuable on this Saturday morning, so we're just going to rock and roll along with it, if you're okay with that.
I'm ready to go.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, Rick, we always like to start off at square one, and we ask, did you have music in the home growing up, whether it was from the radio, or maybe did your family play any instruments?
No, not really. There was music was not a big part of our family life. We didn't turn on the radio and listen when we were in the car, or I don't even remember at the old farmhouse if we even had a record player at the time. I'm sure we did. We'd sing in choir at church. We lived out in the country. And so there were old country churches that, an old United Methodist church we went to for many years. And then an odd combo of a Church of the Brethren that had a retired Assembly of God pastor. And so when we'd sing in the choir, that was kind of the gist of music. I mean, I didn't know who the Beatles were. I remember later when I was in high school and I was singing in the choir there. And then there was this one, they would take like the best of the choir and they'd do this thing they called swing choir. Gosh, it's so cheesy when I think about it now, but it was like, this is late 70s. And I liked it cause you could dance with a girl, you know, in it. And my senior year, I wanted to do that, but I don't want to sing in the regular choir anymore. Say, well, you got to be in the regular choir to be in the swing choir. And I go, well, then I just don't want to be in it. And they go, okay, you can be in the swing choir. And we sang these redone arrangements of different pop stuff that at the time I didn't know about. We sang a Beatles song, and I loved the song. I can't remember what it was now, which one. But it was like, we just didn't know, I didn't know much of anything. And it wasn't until my buddy from high school, who's still a friend this day, and actually at 3 o'clock today, he and two other buddies from college, we all went to college together, are going to do our own little Zoom hang, how you guys doing, check in. But David had in his room, he put on a Dan Fogelberg Netherlands album. And to this day, it's still one of my favorite solo albums of all time, where the marriage of music, melody with the lyrics were just transformative for me. And the next album he played was Larry Norman, Only Visiting This Planet. And so the combination of, it really influenced that Dave had on me, and then started, it intrigued me. And so little by little, I listened to a Journey album in the library at school with my buddy Dick Jones, and one by one. And then the rest was history when I put my penny into the Columbia House thing for 13 different albums. And I do mean albums, LPs, you know, and got Fleetwood Mac Rumors and Boston and Eagles. And I gravitated toward the pop rock stuff. But everything had to have melody that just, it sucked me in. And then when I went to college at Taylor University, I started hearing the similar kind of music, but with different lyrics. And it was that intrigue of how you could take that music that I loved in just like what Larry Norman did, but in more of a pop sense. I just kept evolving through that whole process that I feel like God had me. God made, Mark always said, Gershmo, one of the guys in the band, like, God made music, and it's like a tool, you can do whatever you want with it, you know, just like a knife, you can butter your bread or injure a human, you know. What are we going to do with it? How do we consume it? Mm-hmm. And just God made art inherently attractive. We're drawn to melody. I don't know exactly why, but it's just a beautiful thing. And once I kind of got introduced to it, my latter years of high school, the rest was history.
Well, you know, Rick, thank you for buttering our bread and not injuring us. you've been gifted, and it's a wonderful thing. And thank you to all in Whiteheart. And, you know, I believe music is, like you were saying, it's a wonderful gift. And as the Bible says, every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of the heavenly lights. And it's something innately put in us, right? I mean, you watch a little baby and they hear music. You don't have to tell a baby to start bopping, dancing. They just do. And it's a form of worship, you know? Rick, let me ask you this. Not only are you a dynamic vocalist, but you're also a terrific front man. I was blessed to see you guys one time in 1990 during the Powerhouse tour. So not only are you a great vocalist, but you're a great front man, and you have energy and life. And to me, a great front man, there's somebody who bridges that gap between the band and audience. So did you have any influences? I'm sure part of it, if not all, is natural, but did you see anybody and say, this person has something here? Did you have any influence as a front man?
I don't know that I did, because if you think about back in the late 70s and early 80s, there wasn't a lot, like, if you saw music performed, it was live. There was videos that existed of maybe live concerts and different things, but the access to that kind of stuff wasn't available to everybody. You know, we had an antenna, you know, well, we got, you know, TV into our house, and we had WGN out of Chicago and like two or three other local channels, and that's what you had. So there wasn't me being able to visually see these other artists, and I didn't. The first concert I ever went to was Foreigner, Hot Blooded, at Notre Dame, because I grew up outside of South Bend, Indiana, about 20 minutes. And the next one I saw at Notre Dame was Larry Norman. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have a lot of visual stimulus of what to see what people did really on their live performance. And so I just know what music did when I would listen to it, you know, just like you're saying with that baby bouncing or your head bopping when I'm driving. I just remember driving around in my little Datsun 1200 coupe and just busting the windows out in the country with a inappropriate volume level of whatever I was listening to. And it was interestingly eclectic, where it could have been the Imperials or it could have been, you know, the Eagles or something.
Sure.
And but I do know this, when I first started performing, I was nervous because I'd never done anything like that before. I went from a roadie to the lead singer thing, and it was just maniacally crazy. And it didn't take long to realize that connecting with the audience was really my primary job, the way I saw it. I know they're hearing me sing and run around like a crazy man or whatever, but inside of me, I wanted connection. And that was the thing that brought me the most joy. It makes me happy to think of it now. If you think about it, and we tried to remember this every night, these people got babysitters, or they got, like, this is a big night for them. Mm-hmm. And when you do it every night, you can get sometimes into a rote or technical elements, and you know how the sound's going to be different in this room that we're playing tonight over another night. But ultimately, it comes down to it, we're really just doing this for people to hear us do the art thing that we put together and then have a connection with them. Mm-hmm. And always remember that a lot of times stages, almost always, are higher. Where I'm standing is higher than the people out there. Mm-hmm. Unless you're in like some big arena. And so physically, I might be often looking down at people. But I wanted them to, like, I would connect with eyes the whole night, like lock in eyes on that guy, that lady, that just all night. I wanted to do that. And even if I couldn't see further back because it was dark, I still imagine those connections. And that was easily the best part of doing what I did. It was just like, we're here for the same reason, aren't we? Let's go. Here we go. We're going to do this thing. Yeah. And, you know, and then unleash the insanity. But it was, I loved that part of it. It was beautiful.
Well, and then Rick too, you're probably feeding off the audience too, and all that energy. And that's got to be, I've heard this from other, you know, artists and singers, and the energy that you get back from the audience is almost indescribable from what I can tell.
Well, I don't remember injuring many, but you know,
energy.
Oh, okay. No, I got you. Come on, sing your The energy factor was, I mean, I didn't manufacture that. It was just hyperactivity. And
you could see that energy. It would start in Rick's leg. That leg would get to shaking. And then pretty soon he'd just start rocking with his whole body and be going all across the stage. It was awesome. Yeah.
And we even, like, I remember when with my oldest boy, that we'd be at church and some people in the back, like when we're during singing time at church, where they would laugh because my son's leg did the same thing. Because if there's a melody playing, my leg moves. It's mm-hmm. just, it's going to happen. Yep. And like, I can't really sing because I have to concentrate to make it not move. And then I can't sing. So it's just like there's some extricating. anyway, there's that fancy word that Gersh gave me once that you can't separate it from it. But yeah, my son, at least the number one, I can't remember if two or three. Well, I got five kids, so I can't remember much. But they take it out of you, man. Yeah. And here's my, that's my number four.
Nice.
Oh, up as CJ, sophomore in college right now.
Wow.
So energy. Yeah. It was a lovely thing I got to do. I, you know, it, every job and work or whatever has its, you know, challenges and stuff. But my goodness, I've always said, you know, if I have to go dig ditches, even at 70 to eat food for a living, you know, I need to be thankful because I got to do some really unusually wonderful things.
And it was wonderful, Rick. And we want to thank you and all in Whiteheart. Now, let me ask you this question. Let's go to the source. Let's go to the powerhouse here. Rick, when did your journey with Christ begin?
Well, like I said, growing up, in a lot of times in rural environments, north or south, there is a enculturation of Christianity in many communities, kind of depending on where you are. But, you know, there are some that will have a Damascus Road moment of God calling them 180. And for me, it was kind of more vignettes of time. I remember going forward at a Billy Graham crusade in South Bend. And then David, my buddy from high school, the one who introduced me to Larry Norman and Christian music, was the beginning of that walk. And I even went to, even though we went to another church, I would often go to Dave's youth group. His mom was actually a bishop in the United. She was like the head honcho of Northern Indiana, who she since passed away of cancer many, gosh, 20 years ago, I bet now, maybe more. What a love. Oh, she was so wonderful. Their whole family, man, they're just like, if Ozzy and Harriet do live, they're just lovely. They love people. They're just lovely still to this day. But it was that evolutionary walk, really, of slow growth in my faith. And when I went to Taylor University, it's a small Christian liberal arts university in nowhere. I like to call it nowhere, Indiana. The school that had 1,800 has more people than the town of Upland, Indiana. You look that sucker up on a map. The pizza place is closed down in the summer because when school's out, they can't afford to exist. And they're meeting other people, my peers, that were at different levels. Some people that I probably were still trying to understanding what their faith even was, to those that even to this day, Scott Shaum, a buddy of mine from my floor, he has what's called the Barnabas Project, that they work with equipping missionaries and stuff like that. That the challenges, he's so awesome. The challenges that he would make with me in my faith as a, you know, a 20-year-old, we're both 20 or we're both 21. And I just think of how he, to this day, real normal human being, he played on the football team, but seeing him and his walk evolve and grow, and he's got grandbabies like me now, and just, you know, relationships are a big part of what can encourage or discourage us in our faith, I think. And I even see it in my kids, knowing that we long for, we have little control over who they're going to have friends with, even in high school. And it's really critical, I think. And then, you know, the where do you go to keep sharpening iron as well, just all through life, you know. It's so, as far as the moment, I don't have a date when God had me, you know. It literally could be that Billy Graham crusade. Could have been, there were some moments before that that I remember, moments with him. And so I, you know, it depends on how far the grace of God goes in those sure. moments, as we define that specific moment that he had us.
You just know that he called you, and you just started walking. And I get it.
Yeah.
I understand that.
Don't wait for the movie. Read the book.
Well, Rick, you mentioned something earlier, so I'd love to ask you about this because you're the source here for this. Now, as the tale goes, and you correct me where I'm wrong, but you were a stage manager / lighting tech or roadie for Whiteheart. They were looking for a lead singer after the Hotline period or album, and they heard you singing. And as the tale goes, you became their lead vocalist. So, Rick, how did that transpire?
Well, I had a friend of mine, Chaz Corzine, who worked for Blanton Harrell, who managed Amy Grant and Michael W. And it's so funny, I live in the same town as them. You know, it's like all these, it's a little bastion, Franklin, Tennessee, of a lot of different Christian artists and country artists too. But I had Chaz help me get a job driving a truck for Smitty back in the summer of 85 when I was only about 4 months into town. And I did that gig, and a guy I went to Taylor University with, Jeff Moore, was a year older than me. Well, Jeff had hooked up with one of the Whiteheart guys and produced his first album. And when I came to ending Smitty's gig, Jeff said, hey, they're looking for another stage manager on the Whiteheart tour they're doing in the fall, this Hotline tour, this kind of the second half of the Hotline album tour. And interviewed for that and got the job. I set up front, truss of lights, guitar rigs, and keyboard, just, you know, me and this other dude, we kind of put all the pieces together with other roadies and did our thing. And the one thing, And it wasn't actually singing. They knew that I was in town, was, you know, toying with could I ever sing in music industry world kind of thing. But whenever I was done, the front of house guy would put on some white noise stuff to tweak and EQ the room. And when he was done kind of with that, he would put on they'd always put up a favorite song that sonically they felt like they could hear all the frequencies they needed to hear. And Corey Hart, a Canadian artist, Every Time You Go Away was mm-hmm. this really syrupy ballad kind of thing. And if I was done doing my gig, and it was a beautiful song melodically, I would grab the mic, the lead singer's mic stand and microphone, and I would lip sync on stage, walking around and just like messing around, because what else? I wasn't doing anything else. And found out later, because it's a lot of times it's dark, the lighting guys starting to get their cues together. And so the guys, some of the band guys might be out there back behind the board. And later they said to me, they go like, man, if that dude could ever sing, he would be great on stage.
There you go.
I still think that's so hilarious when I think about it, because I'm not smart enough to do a lot of planning. I just was spontaneous in what I did. Like the first time I did a back handspring on stage in a show, like, I don't remember which one of the guys it was, like poking their finger in my face going like, you are doing that every night.
That's
and
awesome.
It's just, yeah. So yeah, I was on the road crew, and lead singer had to leave. That's a long story in itself. And when they decided they're going to continue, they held auditions. I auditioned with a group of guys, a couple weeks later with a second group of guys, a couple weeks later with a third group of guys. And they asked me to try out on a weekend of shows. Wheaton College out of Chicago was my first show I ever did in February of 86. And yeah, it's just, it's crazy.
Yeah. And then, so in 86, later that year, as people can see behind me, we were blessed with Don't Wait for the Movie. It was your debut with Whiteheart. Following that was 87's Emergency Broadcast, and some choice cuts on both. I mean, Read the Book, Beat of a Different Drum, King George, and then on Emergency Broadcast, Urban Renewal, No Taboo, Speed of Sound, Rick, my question is, I guess starting with 86's Don't Wait for the Movie, you'd done stage managing work and stuff, but did you have any trepidation recording your first album with the band? Had you been around the recording studio environment before?
No. Well, I'll say no, but here I'll give you a little bit of tidbit that I bet you 95% of Whiteheart fans don't know. If you go back and look at the liner notes on the Hotline album, you're going to find on one song a bunch of gang vocals that had like Sandy Patty. You will see my name on it. But the only reason that happened was because I came down in the fall of 84 to visit Jeff because I was thinking of moving down. I graduated actually in December of 84. And I came down in like October, something like that, to pre-visit before I went down. And when I drove in, we got no cell phones. I drove into Jeff Moore's apartment in Bellevue area of Nashville, and he was getting into his car. I'm like, dude, where are you going? It's like, my album just came in the warehouse. We're going over to, it starts with a B. I just now forgot the name of the record label. To go, you know, he's all excited, my first album. So I got in the car, we went over to the studio, and Billy Smiley, the guy that produced it, met him over there. We're like, yeah, look at this, we got your new album, pulled it out. And then Billy goes, hey, Jeff, we're actually doing a gang vocal thing on this, what's going to be a single off the new Hotline album. Why don't you come over and sing with Sandy and Russ Taff's coming over and blah, 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 blah. And he's like, well, Rick just came into town. You know, he sings too. Can he come over? And I remember Billy saying, like, can you read SATB? You know, well, thankfully I was in choir in church growing up. So I understood the SATB thing. And so I'm like, yeah. And so we went over there and I walk in, this kid out of rural Indiana, into this, the Goldmine Studios, where I live just about like 10 minutes, 5 minutes down the road from there now. And went into the studio and there's Sandy Patty and Russ Taff and these other artists. I don't even remember everybody was in it. And I got to sing with all these dudes and dudettes on this album that I didn't know that a year later I was going to be the lead singer for.
That's awesome.
It's like crazy town, nuts stuff. And so I rambled off there, but well, I always loved that little story too from my little history.
Let me ask you, Rick, just out of curiosity, and I know Rex will have a question or two here about Don't Wait for the Movie, but did that song happen to be Heroes by chance?
No.
Okay.
It was ballad.
Okay.
We are his hands, we are his feet.
Okay. I got you. When you were saying gang vocal, and I forgot, you said 84, so that would have been, I think, off the Vital Signs album, maybe.
No, We Are His Hands is from Hotline.
Okay, yeah. I remember. Yeah.
Okay.
And then
you were saying gang vocals, and I just remember those gang vocals and Heroes, and I thought maybe you were one of those people.
Yeah, yeah, I remember. Oh, I hated saying that stuff. It was so dang high. that was, oh my gosh. That was like, and Steve Green, he and I went to church together here for like 25 years. And he moved down to get by some grandbabies in Georgia a couple years ago. But he lived in Franklin, too. But that man, you know, he felt his niche was the inspo music thing. But if you hear him sing on that first Whiteheart album, man, that man can sing.
Oh, yeah.
He's just.
Man, go down Nineveh.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, yep.
Rex, what you got, buddy? I know you had some questions.
Well, we touched on it a little bit, but yeah, your first album for Don't Wait for the Movie, Rick, I mean, I'm assuming you're like probably, were you nervous? I mean, how did it do with recording vocals? Did they really encourage you and help you along with that? Did it take longer than you thought? Or
yeah, it is. When I think about, especially when I thought about it later, almost in life, we have a bunch of guys that all of them became producers in some minor or major way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, Dan Huff, you know, before Gordon came in,
mm-hmm.
You know, Rascal Flatts and you name it. He's done all kinds of mainstream and country artists, plus playing on Michael Jackson and all this other, you know. So the level of, I mean, Tommy Sims, our bass player that we had later, his, you know, the only time Bruce Springsteen didn't use the E Street Band, Tommy Sims played. So we have all of these studio players that people use Whiteheart guys to play on their albums. And then these guys produce other artists. And here I am, farm boy coming in that doesn't know anything. They were patient. And the producer themselves has to be patient, because, and that's a key need for anybody that's going to be a producer. So just how do you sing on mic? You know, how does a pop filter work? And how do you work the mic? You know, there's uni and there's omni and there's different technical things about, and then just putting on phones. And they'll say the phrase, what do you want in your phones? Music.
Right.
Music. Yeah, that'd be good. Music would be good.
So it'd be,
no, do you want, you know, kick, snare, overheads, you know, bass, and how much do you want of these things? And it was, I'm sure for them, incredibly tedious. Walking through those elements, but then over time you start to get it. And because each person, really all I needed is something that gave me time. If it was a certain song that where it's going to have hi-hat type, okay, give me a little of that so I'm on. Because if you don't have anything from the time, sometimes I'd take a click, but there's something a little inhuman about the click.
Yep.
It's almost irritating, mm-hmm. but I'll take it if I need it and just keep it low. Because one thing that I learned over time is many vocalists rush the beat when they're in the studio, and constantly the producer is reining them in. Come on, whoa, bring it back. Listen to the pocket. Where's the pocket? And so that's why when, hearing a phrase like you're on the front side, you know what they're saying is you are almost dang in the pocket, man. You were so, but you're just a little ahead. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I was most encouraged in through the years, that the pocket was not a thing for me vocally. That was my challenge. I had other challenges, but I did not rush. I laid into it. You lay into the pocket, and whenever you lay in the pocket, that is so critical, that tightness. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, we had different hair back then, or more hair.
Well, I was gonna ask you, Rick. So there you are, buddy, the farm boy from Indiana. Now, were you going just for a serious look, a contemplative look, a mad look? What were we doing?
That was one of about 1,800 shots that day on the roof on Second Avenue in downtown Nashville, and we had, you know, lovely helpers around to keep dabbing the sweat off our faces because it was about 88 degrees on that flat rooftop in downtown Nashville. That was actually, of all things, that was on the same block that where that guy bombed with the RV. That was the block, the building we were on at the time, but you know, back in the 80s, but
yeah,
I never even thought of it in that context. I hadn't seen that album cover in a while, made me think of that. But yeah, that was, and the problem with shooting photos for six guys, every shot's got somebody blinking, you know, that's why you got to shoot 18 million or this guy was turned his head to cough or whatever,
right.
You know, takes forever to get photos for band dudes.
Rick, let me ask you about this wonderful album, Freedom. Brown Bannister's notes on the back. Brown Bannister states on the back, if you haven't heard this record, then you haven't heard Whiteheart. And he said, you know, not to discredit any of the past releases, but, and I feel the same way. I mean, I grew up listening to Whiteheart, but when this album hit, I mean, I feel like the band found, like you guys found your sound and your full potential. Yeah. It's the hard rocking to the ethereal. There's so many textures within, but yet it all meshes into one perfect body of sound. Rick, my question about this wonderful album is, like, when you guys were recording in the studio with Brown Bannister, was there a special buzz inside of the studio? Could you all sense this being something special?
Well, we wanted it to be, because it was tough. A lot of the Whiteheart albums were produced by Whiteheart guys, some combination, one or more. And finding a producer that these producers would be willing to listen to, because even if you disagreed with an approach on a song or it was critical to have somebody that you trusted, that when they tell you something, you're inside, you might be going, I don't know, but okay, that's why you got the chair. So let's give it a whirl. And Brown, the Whiteheart guys, obviously not only were studio players, producers, but they're songwriters, right? And they wrote songs for other artists too. Mm-hmm. So it is you got that factor. And when you're trying to put an album together, and for many of us in that era, Freedom was our favorite album, and it is for me. And it wasn't just necessarily the combination of the guys, but the way that everything came together, you know, almost like organically, that it was like a chemistry lab at the Bennett House in downtown Franklin, of watching these pieces come together and little creative moments when Tommy all of a sudden started playing this bass line that you're like, what the stupid thing was that? Mm-hmm. You know, again, you know, and he's like, whoa, dude. Like, that man, God shoved all his brain onto the creative side. He's got no room in his brain for anything else. That guy can hardly add one and one, but he is so gifted. But it is from that to a moment on, I think it's Power Tools, where I was talking with Gordon the other day, where when we, I was holding a mic. This is an old historic house from the 1800s in downtown Franklin. And the ambient sound in a lot of it, hardwood floors, 12-foot ceilings, great for Chris's huge limbed drum sounds. And there's this one spot where you hear this distant sounding like yelling. And what it was is Gordon about five rooms over, and he starts running from one room with one big gulp of air going, but he's running closer and closer until he runs down this hallway where I'm at the end of the hallway holding this microphone waiting for him to get there, and he's sprinting, and I remember him like sliding and almost banged into me. And that's just one little piece of goofballness that we're trying to add into a song that's kind of insane. And the Power Tools thing, and rolling an aerosol can across, if you listen at the beginning, you're going to hear this walk up, walk up, walk up, walk up. It's an aerosol can rolling across the hardwood floor, and we're chasing it with a microphone, but try not to make any sound when you do that. And even you'll hear it's the aerosol, we're spraying the aerosol can. just crazy stuff. And running a mic out to the car at 2 a.m. because we found a preacher on 2 a.m. on an AM radio station saying something about, you put your hand on my gold Bible, and which we weren't too keen on, but which was part of the theme of that song.
Yes. Like,
I don't know. This might be kind of scary what this guy's saying. And so catching those kind of things was, you know, that was just moments of laughter, tussling over lyrics. No, you're an idiot. No, that we're not doing that one. And then, because I remember through the years of sometimes having theological moments of like, we can't say that. I remember Gersh and I got a little irritated with each other nicely. We weren't swinging or nothing. But it was like, no, you know, I'd want to say the phrase, that's not biblical. Can't say that. That's not right. And he goes, and I remember, and Gordon would say this sometimes too, where you would have, what do they call it? Poetic license. They would say the phrase. We know that's what it says, but that you obviously understand what we mean. And I'm like, okay, whatever. You guys are really good writers anyway, so we'll go. But there is, to this day, there's a song that we had that I would never sing the lyric of the song live, what we did on the album, because it bothered me theologically. He is on Desert Rose.
Mm-hmm.
The phrase, like, this is full confessions now, is like,
sure.
He will love you for the things you do.
Right.
And theologically, yes. And theologically, that is not true to me. That because it is not, that comes off as earned. I'm very reformed in my theology, and I go to a Presbyterian church. And it is like, but they're saying, you know, that's not what we're saying. And but I'm like, that's what I'm saying, because I'm singing the darn words, dude. And so I would say, I would sing, he loves you. And then, as silly as this is, oh, the things you do. Well, what does that even mean? I don't mean nothing, but it doesn't matter. At least I didn't sing for the things you do, because I don't agree with that lyric.
Hey, Ray, you should have said poetic license, baby. I'm taking poetic license.
Well, and that it is. And, you know, in the realm of eternity, I don't think we're, you know, in danger of, you know, sending people to Hades because of bad theology. No, I know. I'm very bombastic.
Well,
in my
let me ask you about another poetic license song.
Yeah.
Tell me the deep theology behind, and this is actually one of my favorite little portions here. Tell me the deep theological meaning behind Schwipple Dips.
Yeah, that is, remember what I said a little while ago, God shoved all of Tommy's brain with the art side and creativeness, you know, the other side of his brain that does 101 is 2, is there's no room for that. So it was just, Tommy would, his nickname a lot in the band was Satellite. Like, us, whoo, that boy is where, well, I don't know where he is, but he's out there somewhere. Like, we would be, oh, that man, what a mess. He's crazy. And no, it was just a thing. It meant absolutely nothing. It was just a thing that came out, just like when some other artist would make some sounds. He just making sounds that had a vibe and a feel to him that just like, there was an empty space, like pop. Now there's quiet. That came out. And then everybody in the studios, like, laughing out loud. They're like, what the heck was that?
Yeah.
It was awesome. And it ended up being on the album.
Heck yeah. Heck yeah. Rex, I don't want to hog up the time with freedom. I know you had some questions.
Well, I mean, and you can just tell, and you've alluded to this, Rick. I mean, that was just like a magical time in making that album. And you can just tell it. The whole album is just incredible. And you could, I don't think you could really capture that again. And it is my personal favorite Whiteheart record too. And, you know, to me, that's where you guys really you know, you're at the peak now for several albums after this. This is like, you know, I feel the best Whiteheart time frame musically to this album and albums that follow. But it's just cool to hear these stories. And I Kent's kind of asked the question, really, but I just, yeah, you could just tell that you guys hit on all cylinders on that album.
You know, it even saying that of the, you know, most bands' lifespan are one album, and they're done. And it's funny, at our church, Cademan's Call is practicing this week. They're doing two shows at the Ryman, getting back together just to do a couple shows. But it is like Gordon and Gersh and another friend, Blair Masters, who's a keyboard player. We see each other a lot. Relationship, bands in relationship. Some of, you know, there were moments of, it's like family, you know, so there's moments of frustration, irritation, love, joy. It's just like life. And you're doing this life together. And then when God put together some form of synergy at that moment and some moments beyond, it's just, it's lovely. But what I love now at 60 years old is, man, that's old. So is the idea of that, I'm so thankful I got to do that, but let's just come over and hang out and laugh about stuff we're doing today and stuff we did back then and just be together with each other. It is like, I'm so thankful that I get to do that, that I got to do that thing, you know, play all over the world, be in front of, you know, bunches of humanity. And yet at the same time, we sit on my back patio here and, you know, break bread together and just, it's been a wonderful life. It's not perfect by any stretch. Life has all of its challenges along the way. But my goodness, I have just so much to be thankful for. It's crazy.
So Rick, let's delve in a little bit to this wonderful album my goodness. So my favorite all-time Whiteheart song is Independence Day. I mean, You guys just rock that song. So the good news is, like Rex said, a string of brilliant albums from Whiteheart, beginning, not to discredit anything from the past, but, you know, but no, from Freedom onward, I'm locked in. So with Powerhouse in 1990, we got the wonderful Independence Day, the title track Powerhouse, Desert Rose, minus that one little poetic license snippet. But I'm not a big ballad guy, but I got to say that Desert Rose is terrific. I think it's a wonderful song, and it just is wonderful. So another great rock album. My question about this time period, we had to say goodbye to Gordon and Tommy and Chris, but we also welcomed Brian Wooten, Anthony Salee, Mark Niemer on this album. And then, as we would later get into, the wonderful John Knox on drums, a great lineup again. My question here, Rick, is with this album, due to the lineup change, was it harder for the band to prep recording for this album in light of new personnel, or was it an easy going situation in the studio here?
You know, I don't recall it not being, you know, I feel like there was I just feel like we had gone through that when Chris and Gordon and Tommy left, that was a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
That was a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Because individually and together, I remember when Gordon was telling me not long after they all started going to do more, just be more studio session guys. And what was that? There was a pop artist, Jewel. I don't know if you remember her from, like, I guess that had been around 1990 or 92, that Chris, I think it was Dan Huff, was the producer, and he had that former Whiteheart rhythm section, you know, Gordon and Tommy and Chris playing on that album. And it was, you know, but Brian Wooten, when he came in, like, it ain't like he doesn't know what he's doing. And he's been playing for, like, I think, is it Trace Atkins? I think maybe for like 15 years or more. Like, so it isn't like they're just different guys. Not, we didn't like skip a beat. It's just, it's different guys.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was maybe just a learning curve of when Brian's guitar sounds or solos and how he does them, or, you know, each one of those, like Anthony Salee, you know, and he's still in town here too. I remember Gersh said he was texting A-Tone, as we called him. It was just different. It wasn't like, again, it was just, it was a different kind of relearning, you know, each guy's, how that, because there's so much in it in recording technically. There's a lot of technical stuff and things that if you were a listener sitting on the couch in the lounge or right behind the control room, there's a lot of stuff that would bore people. Because they're like, play the darn song, play the, it's like, and but for an hour sitting there tweaking that amp sound, you know what? You know, move that one out. Pull in the, you know, this fender. Pull in the fender and then tweak that. Like, constant listening through and evolving through these different sounds till you think you're, okay, now let's try that one with this. And then, you know, so there's a lot of this kind of stuff that it was once, like, when Gordon left and all these different guys, it's just relearning how guys make their sounds. And then what's the producer want from a sound standpoint? Sometimes they don't touch it and sometimes they tweak a lot of it. And so, yeah, I just remember, and Niemer is more of like a jazz guy kind of. He's a little more fluid than like Chris McHugh, who's my roomie till I got married. You know, he's got arms the size of my thighs. You know, the only guy that I ever saw break graphite drumsticks, which are the unbreakable ones. You know, when he broke his sticks, he was so consistent. If you looked at the stick, there was this middle part that looked like a beaver had been gnawing at it, and it started splaying out like this until it busted. And you watch, if you ever see Chris, like, he's doom doom god doom doom, how he can grab a new stick right out of a stick bag right next to the tom and not miss a single beat. Oh, when a stick had just bam, grab it, bam. That was just hilarious. He was so gifted. He still is gifted. So yeah, I ramble so much, but it is definitely it was a learning curve, but we had, you know, it was fine. It was just like, because so much of it is you're developing these songs anyway. In processing them and evolving them, what we almost always did, maybe always, I don't remember, is before we went into the studio, because it's expensive back in the day, how we recorded then, as opposed to people doing it now, like we'd spend at least $150K just to make an album.
You guys, in my humble opinion, I'm not saying it was your only masterwork, but Freedom was a masterwork to me. Mm-hmm. And Sparrow, that was your last album with Sparrow. Now, I do, so a little bit of a separate question. Did, with Powerhouse, you guys began your relationship with Starsong. Was it just that your contract with Sparrow was up, or did Freedom create enough of a wave that Star Song said, hey, we'll make you an offer you can't refuse?
Let's see. So Star Song was after Sparrow, and most, at least with us and many of them, you would do a 3-album deal, like contract wise. And after that, I don't remember specifically, Daryl Harris, who was like that ran the ship, wonderful man. But Billy, you know, Billy Hearn and his son, Billy Ray, it's like, I don't remember. Sometimes it can just be from a business standpoint. It was a better way to go for us. I don't really remember the detail of that, what evolved from one to the next. I do know the first 3 albums that they needed to get out of that, because that was just a horrible scenario. Through the years, like, the thing about Christian music is there are some of the most godly people you'd ever meet in your whole life, who's at their core thoughtful, kind, generous, but then there's a few that, you know, are you somehow, what are you in the Christian music business for? And there, you know, it's always a challenge, because you have ministry stuff you're doing, but then it's your living. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember running into people say, you should do this for free because this is your ministry. It's like, dude, how do I eat?
I've got to feed my family.
Yeah. What do you want me to do? You know?
Right.
And that was always a challenge to watch that balance, I guess I would say. Mm-hmm.
So, moving right along, Rick, another wonderful album, In Tales of Wonder, came out in 1992. Now, as with Freedom, many among my peers in college, so I was in college from Freedom through Highlands. With this album, many of my peers, they've put this on the same peer as Freedom, Tales of Wonder. Every track save for 2 on this album charted on the CCM charts. We get Unchained, we get Say the Word, a host of other great songs on here. His Heart Was Always in It. So, Rick, my question about this album, let's take Unchained and Say the Word. As with the song Messiah on Powerhouse, my question is, how did you and Gersh determine the vocal parts? I mean, you have a naturally higher range. But on the song arrangements, how did you all say, hey, you know, Gersh, you take this part and I'll do that? How did y'all work that out with different songs?
You do. There are certain ones, sometimes when you're woodshedding the songs, I remember what I was trying to say before we went in the studio, we would rent out for like 2 weeks a performance hall to evolve the songs further, because what would often happen if we didn't do that, because they didn't do it in the early years, you get in the studio and you're evolving it in the studio, but you know, time is money, and by the time you finish that album, get on the road, you'd start doing some new things to that song that you wish you would have got it on the album. So we went to recording or to performance halls to rehearse these songs. And a lot of times when we went, we might have had 15 songs. Like, we had 30, but we didn't think, that one's going to be for something else, or that's not it. And a lot of times, to get it down to the 10, we had to evolve them in the performance hall until we got it. And then you also, the arrangement of the song itself, you find every once in a while, you might even change the key on the thing. The key of the song that felt most natural at times was just better for Gersh, and then ones for me. Mm-hmm. And So it was like the songs themselves kind of created that. There was like a natural, almost organic, like, yeah, Gersh has got to do the verses on that, and I'm going to hit the chorus. And, you know, like a song, Gabriella, that was Gersh because it was a song about his Gabriella. And mm-hmm. and so that kind of thing would sometimes, you know, step in and be in the purpose in that.
Rick, did I read somewhere, maybe my mind is playing tricks on me, but did I read somewhere in an interview that you had previously given, did you say something to the effect that you thought that Tales was kind of like the essence of Whiteheart put to album, meaning it was the best representation of the band as a whole?
I don't remember. I said all kinds of stuff, and half the time I don't remember. I would say, you know, there was something about, like, is that the one that has Unchained on it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Let's see, how would you say, because it sounds like it belittles it to say, like, CHR kind of pop, like a little more of a pop feel than a rock feel on some of it, in a way that, like, even when I think of the video we did for that song, Unchained, there's something about, we always, almost always did, you know, a lot of gang vocals on choruses.
Mm-hmm.
Layers and layers, like you're listening to 12 to 18 singers on a chorus, but we would do it in a way that tries to sound like one voice. When you're singing three, like a three-part harmony, you are still wanting that to sound not like three different guys singing, but, you know, because there's a way that you can pick out the three different vocalists from each of the notes, but whenever you can make that harder to determine that, mm-hmm. and then you layer those things, it sounds like an instrument itself sometimes. And so all that to say is, I would think of more vocally the constant evolution of our hearing and singing together. The more years that you do that, the more that you do it effortlessly, still work, but you don't have to work at it as hard.
Mm-hmm.
You it's almost just like when you find that, okay, here's this, working the mic, they would say the phrase, like, how close do I need to be? Sometimes, a lot of times we'd try to sing on the same mic, and many times that would work. But sometimes it might be in a frequency where Gersh has got to get hotter on the mic, Rick back off. Because when you hit that one phrase, it's biting, you're outshining the other dudes. We got to get it to that one sound and not separating it. Oh, there's Rick's. You can hear Rick's, you can hear Gersh or Billy. And so some of, when I think of that, I think of some of the, that album and the vocals, hits me a little bit more, and ethereal sounding, some of the keyboard stuff that Gersh did on the album and stuff. It was a little more swimmy, kind of stuff at times.
Mm-hmm.
And Highlands kind of got to that point too, where, where you kind of evolved into like the next generation from the one to that.
This was a terrific album as well, 1993. The thing that I, there was much to love on Tales of Wonder. There's not a Whiteheart album I don't like you know, at all from Freedom and Beyond, especially. But what I loved about Highlands is I'm a little bit more of a harder rocker, and this starts getting into some of that a little bit more than Tails did. Now, Rick, I don't know if you can agree with this assessment or not, but some of my peers have compared Whiteheart, like from Freedom and onward. Do you remember Yes during the big generator era in the 90125? And then you had Kansas with Power and Kansas with Drastic Measures. And a lot of people have kind of said it's rock, but it's got little flourishes or nuances of prog, streamlined prog. Yeah. Could you agree with that assessment?
Yeah, that's a better way to say it than I did. Because the when I think of, was it 90120 or whatever?
90125, yeah.
The Yes album stuff and the sound of what Yes was. They had their own evolution through stuff, but there was still Yes. Mm-hmm. You know, there's still Yes. And it is a, I don't know. I would agree. There are times where Gersh, where there's a little bit more keyboard emphasis on some of those albums, maybe than there had been in the past, even though it was always a significant part of the different albums. But when you move away from some of the hardness rock stuff, that just, you know, that's what made the difference. I think for me is the element of vocal meshing and evolution, and then the keyboard presence in a little bit more.
Well, you guys have always been applauded, and still to this day, one of our friends, Jeremy Brown from Torrential Riff, he applauds the production with these albums, and of course we all do. They're superb. What I loved about Whiteheart and love about Whiteheart is you guys were rock, Rick, but it just wasn't paint by numbers rock. There was that just little nuances of progginess in there. Now, Whiteheart could rock with the best of them, but you guys also weren't afraid of the ballads either. I don't know. I might be shooting myself in the foot with this question. Maybe it's a silly question, but Rick, did you have a personal preference between the rock numbers as juxtaposed with the ballads? Did you have a preference on which style to sing?
Well, you know, there's a difference between studio singing and live. So just like Independence Day, like live, I get to lose myself in the rhythm of the dance, and that energy of kind of the bombastic physical nature of some of these songs that I get to be rather frenetic, which is natural for me when I'm singing. And so that comes to mind, mm-hmm. that I would, from a live standpoint, I would also just say, like, if I was having a bad night, I can hide in a more energetic song than on a ballad. A ballad, you're more naked, like you got it tonight or you don't got it. And so, but there is something about, again, melody, whatever, that carries the day. There's maybe it's a different kind of connection of that, what a rock song will do in an anthem sense with an audience, as opposed to, you know, the ballad thing where intimacy that comes with the ballad kind of scenario.
Give your body, give your mind, give it all up to you. So, Rick, if you don't mind, regarding Inside, it came out in 1995, and there was a switch from Star Song then to Curb Records. The band went a little darker and heavier with this release on some songs. Grunge had its advent circa 91. Did the darker and heavier textures on this album, was that something that was kind of, did grunge kind of come into play with a little bit of the soundscape on this album?
Well, that was a pivotal album for me, more maybe so than the rest of the guys, because that is when my wife left our relationship. And the devastating nature of that for me was like, I always like to say, it was getting shipped to Mars, but I had no experience with living on Mars, and I don't know what that's like. Got three little boys and stuff, and it was just so incredibly hard. And it was devastatingly hard. And so trying to do this art thing in the midst of hurt and fears and all those different things became a part of, like, the song Inside is where that came from for me. One of the fewer songs, I wasn't one of the primary writers through the years, but that song was mine. And not mine exclusively, but that came from my hurt and my, you know, yelling out to God. And so, and that's why that song became, the sound of that song was, you know, the origin of all of what it was. And it's so funny, like, that is the only song we ever had that had a Grammy nomination. And it was, of all the songs that we could say, like, well, what about that song and that song? And it just has always seemed odd to me that that song had a Grammy nomination when some of these other ones, you know, I don't know. But the grunge thing, yes. And that was the part of getting to the point for me. And when people said, like, why did you stop the band? Why'd you quit? And I always like to say there were 18 reasons. I don't know what they were, but they're 18. I don't know where 18 came from, but that's what I always said. But music, when Nirvana started doing their thing, that was, it musically amazing. It was very sad lyrically, and, you know, obviously where he was and ending his life eventually, that was, but music was changing. And that was the first time that a few of us, me and probably Gers, we felt like it was departing so much from where we were that we didn't ever want to feel like we were followers of, like, we're going to do the, okay, now we got to sound more like Nirvana kind of thing. And when it felt like that was almost what we were going to have to do, because there's always this evolution in popular music, you know, hip hop and what it became. And I always like to say, because every generation has their style of music they like. There's, you know, some of my kids, you know, like Eagles. And then, God forbid, some of my kids like hip hop. And, but I always say I like hip hop better than rap, if I'm being kind. But I've also learned to understand how it's silly to say that there's not a place for rap musically. Well, even though half the time there isn't music in it, but that's part of my issue with personal, you know, things of music genre stuff. But anyway, all that to say is music was changing, and I felt like I was warned from the hurt of the relationship side of things, and then music was changing. It was after Inside, it was like I was feeling like, not feeling like, I was like telling the guys, I think I'm pretty much done, you know, and whatever my 18 reasons were, and some of it was like, okay, now that I'm grown up, what am I going to do with my life if I don't? I considered some solo stuff, or whatever and talk to a few guys about that. But it just like, as one of the Whiteheart songs is, my heart was not in it. It had kind of run its course. And when the Redemption album came to pass, when I was telling the guys, I don't want to do, I'm done. And Mike Kerb is a wonderful guy to work with. And I said, like, guys, I'm done. And Mark and Billy got together and they wrote a bunch of songs, mm-hmm. and they played them for me and said, you know, what if we do just one more? Let's do one more. And I go, well, as long as you guys are okay that we don't tour it, I'm not going to tour it. And as long as the label's okay with footing the bill money-wise for it, and we're not going to tour it. And Mike said, that's fine. Which not many record label, well, you know, being a mainstream label, they have other artists that probably foot the bill for us, you know, Tim McGraw and Leanne Rimes and a whole bunch of country guys that they were doing at the time. He could afford to let us do another album. And so that's why nobody ever heard Redemption really. You know, we'd usually sell about 150, 200,000 albums when we did our thing. And I don't remember how many that sold, but it was virtually nothing. And because there was no, you know, working the album, so to speak. But I will tell you, to this day, there's some of my, like, if I would go back and listen to a song or two, there were things that were unique to that album. That, and in the players too, like Mark Hill, who's one of the best, you know, bass players in this town, and just the different guys. It was like no other thing we did to me. Mm-hmm. Part of it was because the players were not like Whiteheart guys. It was just like a bunch of us went in to record some songs that Mark and Billy wrote. And also, not having the, okay, now we're going to have to think of touring for this. And sometimes when you're recording, this was just, we're going in to record almost like when you went to do demos, but, you know, doing it at a master level. But it was a little cathartic-y because of where I was personally in life at that time. There's some beauty in some of those songs. That because it wasn't even really pop, it was just but they weren't, yeah, there were some ballads and stuff, but it was just different than anything that we'd done, and I'm really glad that we did it, and there are songs that I really like.
You had Looking Glass, and Overboard was a favorite. Mm-hmm.
Looking Glass, I love the melody of that song. When they started playing it, I was that was one of the things that drew me in to do the album.
Steel and Stone, The Vine, that's cool.
Vine's a beautiful melody.
Fall yep. on Me, Love mm-hmm. is Everything, that was cool.
Oh, Love is Everything's great.
Yeah. And then, you know, we gotta remember this. That was cool, you know, and it was actually a very good album. At the time, I had some issues in 97 relating to this because it was so different. But, you know, as Rex and I talk, our palates expand, right, as we grow older and mature. I've grown to really love this album. It's a very mature and, like you said, nothing else sounds like it's kind of dark, kind of moody. But it's very good. So friends out there, if you haven't given Redemption a shot, give it a shot. I don't want to pass Rex up. Rex, did you get Inside real quick?
Yeah. And Rick, you know, I really think Inside, you know, I just listened to it again the other day. And I tell you what, that album deserves more attention than what it got to, I think, at the time. Because that is a really good album. I did not know about your personal history at the time, what was going on with that album. But like with going to Curb Records and kind of being, you know, they're a mainstream label. Were you happy? I don't want to put you on the spot, but were you happy with how it got promoted? I just sort of seemed to at the time fly under my radar a little bit. And I know the whole grunge thing was going on, and I know the whole music industry was kind of in turmoil, like what do we do now type of thing. So were you happy with that, or were you just, you know?
The A&R girl at Curb, he had brought over from Geffen Records, and like she'd worked with Henley, you know, Don Henley and Yes, and she was a song lady, like tune plugger. Like she had, you know, Claire was just really, really talented lady, very opinionated, very loving, who has since passed away just a couple years ago. What a sweetheart. Man, she, it's just so sad. She was, made my wife sad too. We had become good friends even after left the, you know, the music thing, and we're friends till the day she died. But it was, whenever as an artist, you can like, man, do whatever you want. Do whatever you want. And then they'll tell you when you start playing them the stuff you're doing, you know, they got their feedback and thoughts, and they try to see the vision for what you're creating in the pieces of the puzzle. And, you know, she had enough, there was even talk that on the Inside album, she would see if, we could, it would have been a stretch to open for Coldplay when the albums, the contacts that they had in the mainstream thing, but that never fruition. But I don't think they even, I don't know. I just remember hearing that. It's like, okay, I can actually see the kind of the heart even of some of those guys and what they do. I don't know. Think about it, how long it's been too, you know. My wife and I, present, you know, I've been married to her for over 25 years, you know, and I was out of the music industry when we got married, you know, so it's like, this has been so long. Some of these details have fallen into the mist and wisp of my limited gray matter. And so I, you know, some of it is trying to recall,
right?
You know, just and it's like, and again, when it's just like, if your heart's not in that whole thing, you know, I go back to where, you know, I would rather, like, when I'm showing property as a realtor, showing some farmland or showing some forest areas, some guys might want some deer hunting property, and walking out on 100 acres or two, like in the fall and winter, that's like, love it. That I am not working when I'm doing that. When I'm just walking through the woods, and you know, I have a biology degree that I never used professionally. That was my degree I got at Taylor University. And I've always been, loved being close to creation. And when you grow up in the country, it becomes a part of your, you know, a vegetable garden. It's a half an acre, and, you know, chickens and horses, and just living out amongst the intimacy of creation around you is what I still love. And so now that I, even in my real estate work, get to do that, I'll tell my clients, I'm like, man, this, I ain't working today. I am just loving it, loving being out here, and makes my heart happy. So that's really at core who I am. I've just got to take a 12-year hiatus from, you know, what might be a normal life, and do this crazy town, awesome, wonderful thing, and still have some best friends from it. And that's why I just go back to, I'm just thankful for what I got to do.
Hey, Mr. Nice Guy, I don't know your name.
Well, Rick, let me ask you really quick in closing out. Do you all happen, does Whiteheart have, do you all have any recordings that you've recorded but maybe aren't on an album?
Oh, yeah. There's a few things. I remember we were kicking tires with Gordon and Gersh and I about going doing a little thing here and there. We actually did a 30th, the Freedom 30-year reunion, and Brown got on stage. Half of it was talking, and we played the whole album. Except Set the Bridge on Fire, because that song's evil.
I love that song, man.
It's horrible. Brown Bannister had to use a whip to get me through that song. It was so high vocally.
Great.
Oh my gosh, it killed me.
It's great, dude.
No, it's horrible. Evil dwells in the land of Satan.
Or at least just take key. Some poetic license and sing.
Yeah, no, it was just the key, dude. That was all it was. And my broker at where I'm a real estate agent, he teased, and we have conversations about that. He used to be in the Christian music industry on the business side of things. And I've told him, like, that's why I never did that one live, dude, because it was so dang high. I don't know if I could have done it live, and I didn't want to have a train wreck live. So now he teases me all the time. We were on a fantasy football thing that, he used that phrase, like, I think like his name was, you know, Set the Bridge on Fire or something like that was his name for the, just as having fun anyway.
So Rick, in closing out, just to make mention of a couple little things, on April 19th, 2014, it was your all's first full concert performance since 1998 at Easterfest in Toowoomba, Australia.
Oh yeah.
August 25th, 2006, Whiteheart, you all were the recipients of the Soul to Soul Honor Award in New Albany, Indiana, and you all were also inducted into the Christian Music Hall of Fame on November 6th of 2010. Rick, I mention these things because what are your thoughts in closing out about, what are your thoughts about being in a band as beloved as Whiteheart? You guys are loved and you guys certainly haven't been forgotten.
Yeah, I mean, I get messages on Facebook, which I'm hardly ever on any social media, but we get those frequently, like every week. And it's still, I always want it to be humbling, and it just still makes me shake my head. Just like, you remember at the time when you're standing on the stage and then said that thing at the beginning where this is important to them, that they came tonight, they invested time and money to be here. And now they're reflecting back, almost like you guys are, of what these different artists brought creatively that meant so much to you. So I never want to go like, leave me alone, you know? Like, I'm too busy, I don't have time. So I try to send a quick, you know, sentence or two out back to somebody who says something to encourage them in their encouragement of me and of what the band did. It's humbling, and I'm thankful, and makes my heart happy that people receive some form of musical enjoyment, faith, connectivity, you know, something that, you know, there were commonly people were saying, like, it was what put me on my journey to my walk that I still have today with my God. And I know that has therefore nothing to do with Rick. It is like, we were just doing some things that God used that tool to do the things that he does. You know, I remember Arlen Troyer, a guy that actually played a few live shows with us while we were transitioning from Tommy. And he's a buddy of mine from college, played with Jeff Moore for a while. He had just said, you got to remember, you know, God can use Motley Crue. You know, it may not be even the same way that he used. It might be somebody going like, this ain't right. Something ain't right here. What's not right?
Yeah, God used Pharaoh.
So good. Yeah. So it's like remembering that God's got it all. You know, he's got the big picture. He's you know, we know the end of the story. Mm-hmm. We're just in the middle of the story, working it out right now. So we each keeping that, you know, the end results should be our ultimate hope, that we just know that we know how the story ends.
Yeah.
So, you know, be encouraged.
Well, Rick, Rex and I, we just appreciate everybody in Whiteheart and so many of these bands that follow Christ as individuals have ministered to us. I was doing the math. I started listening to Whiteheart during the Vital Signs album, and that was an 84 release. So I'm 51 now. I was 13 back then. And if I asked about any recordings that you all have that might not be on an album, I'd hope maybe one of these days you guys could entertain releasing that material on some type of an album. Just food for thought. So we know your time is valuable, Rick. And I do have to ask you one last question. What is the story officially behind changing your first name with every album? How did that come about?
It happened as one of the dumb heads in the band go like, we're just going to drop the K. Let's just, you know, just be kind of different. And then I'm like, dude, there's no K on my, it's like, yeah, just be, you know, kind of it different, you know? And I'm like, put the K on there. So the next album, put the K on. And then what became the most hilarious thing on interviews all the time is like, hey, I saw RIC on the RIK. How do you spell your name? So we go like, you guys are like yapping about, you didn't ask about that bass line on the thing like that. You're like going, and so just to perpetuate the insanity, you know, we spelled the next album. Spelled it a different way. And then say, hey, I saw on this album, you spelled it with a blah, blah. And we're like, look at each other and go like, man, they're still going with that thing. Like they're paying attention to that. So it was like this side little vignette of like, okay, let's keep her going. Just see what kind of, yapping goes on about it. It was just a little silly side note that became a fairly frequent conversation piece of folks along the way. But it just happened. One guy just said, do it to be different. And then the questions that kept coming made us perpetuate it.
Well, it was awesome. And it was kind of a fan to band thing, you know, the little joke with your name. So
I know.
Thank you for that. Rick, we're going to close out, and whenever we do, we always bring a message from home. Rexy's going to read just a quick verse of scripture, because we like to keep the main thing the main thing, and we'll close out, and please stick around for one more minute after that.
Okay.
Well, I want to give a quick shout out to my buddy Malcolm Paris from The Brave. I was having some serious computer issues with my iTunes library, and he was able to fix me up with that. So I just want to say thank you, Malcolm, and I really appreciate all your help with that. The message that scripture that I come up with here, Rick, I immediately knew what I was going to do. And like Kent said, the first album that I ever got from Whiteheart was Vital Signs. And the first song on that album is Sing Unto the Lamb. And that song, every time I hear it, just gives me so many great memories. And so the scripture for that I've picked is Psalms chapter 96, verses 1-3. And the scripture says, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the people. And the band has done that or did that for over 15 years, Rick. And we as fans are just so grateful for you and all the members in Whiteheart. And we just want to say thank you for all the great memories you've given us.
Oh, thank you so much. We were thankful to be a part of the whole picture. All of us, one big old family.
Well, Rick, thank you so much for your time. And it was an honor to have you, sir. And thank you and everyone in Whiteheart for being vessels used by the Lord to bless us. So we appreciate that. And friends, we're just going to sign off from here. Take care, everybody. Thanks.
Bye.
Bye-bye.